The next one, the spiral model. Now, this is usually used for very complex projects, which are very critical, complex, and hard to implement. Right? Where there are too many risks involved in the system, you generally tend to go for a spiral model. Okay. Now, let me give you a context of where this could be useful, and then I think you'll be able to relate. Now, let's say there is a new technology, okay, completely new technology, and you want to implement your core system in that particular technology. So, existing system is, let's say, in mainframe system, an old green screen system, wherein you don't even have a GUI and all is, you will have to type in using your keyboard. So that kind of system is there, but it is your core system, and you want to migrate that into a latest technology. Let's say Java using struts or whatever it is. Okay. Now, there are too many unknowns in this project. So you could feel that, whether that new technology, Java, could support the kind of volumes which are being processed by my system. Right. So let's say that there are 2,000 transactions which are 20 million transactions which have to be processed in a particular day. Okay. Now the old system is supporting, that, but you don't know whether the new system would support those kind of number of transactions or not. Okay. So you should not be in a situation that you capture all the detailed requirements about the system. You spend 6 months capturing all the detailed requirements. You spend some $1 million for those requirements, and then during the design you figure out, this system doesn't support the number of transactions. Okay. Now all your money which you have spent, all the $1 million for capturing the detailed requirements, is gone waste. And so there is no use of it, because you cannot implement in the new system. Right. Now at that point you will think, we should have actually looked at this risk right at the start of the project. Right. So that's exactly what we are doing in a spiral model. So when you start the project and then figure out there are too many risks, what you would do is you will find out what are my key objectives of my system. You will find that first. Right? Let's say my first key objective of the project is to support that volume of transactions. Because not all technologies can support. So I just want to make sure that before I start the detailed implementation of the system, I'll make sure that the technology is supported. So the first step is basically to figure out whether the number of transactions are supported or not. So I'll figure out what are the risks involved in it, and then do some small, I'll pick up one functionality and then ensure that 20 million transactions can be processed. Right? Once that is successful, then I'll move on to the next topic, the next set of objectives, and then incrementally go with the development. Right? So my second objective could be, it should support some 100,000 customers, 100,000 users. Okay, when 100,000 users log in, the system should not crash. Then I'll go back and then do some development and make sure that, I test that functionality. So the second objective is to ensure that number of users are supported. And let's say, you've done that development as well. Now the third objective or key requirements would be, I want these 3 new features to come in, right? So you just do the development of that, and then, incrementally, or a risk-based approach you're taking up, and with each prototype, you're developing the system, right? So this way, if any point, if you feel that the risks are high, and, you're not able to meet the requirement, you could just stop the project. So your costs are much more contained in that kind of scenario. Even if the project fails, you are not wasting a lot of money. Okay, so that is basically a risk-based approach, where you are judiciously using your budgets, and then trying to implement the system within the minimum spent. Okay. Usually this is used for very complex kind of projects, but again it's similar to an iterative model in a sense, right? So with each iteration you'll have a defined scope, and then you'll have to do that. just that before identifying those iterations, you are figuring out what are your objectives, what are your key risks involved with it, and then carrying it out in an iterative model. Would be similar to your iterative model. All right.